1 John chapter 4, verse 19. We love him because he first loved us. Would you say that with me together? Let's say that together. We love him because he first loved us. Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning. God, we thank you for the wonderful songs this morning, Lord, that just presented the gospel in such a fantastic way, God. Lord, we thank you for those that are here this morning. Lord, I pray now that you open up our hearts, that you open up our minds, God, to be able to receive your word. Lord, may it go within us, do a mighty work, Lord, and may we go out and tell others about you. For it's these things I ask in the precious name of Jesus, and amen. You can be seated. Well, I dare to say, if you would go around and take a poll of people that are professed Christians, people that say they've been saved by the blood of Jesus, if you would go to ask them why they love Jesus, no doubt you will hear many different things from people. I mean, there's a whole lot of different things of why people love Jesus. I mean, I've heard, you know, everything, because he saved me. Of course, that should be right at the top of our list. He brought me out of darkness, for those that were in the darkness, and we all were before we were saved. We were in the darkness. Or maybe because he saved my life. I've known people that's been on the brink of suicide, that God has intervened and took over and has entered into their heart and changed their mind and changed their life and saved them. But if you think about it, if he saved you this morning, he saved your life. But if you go and ask these people exactly why they love God, no doubt you probably won't hear many people say, because he first loved me. But that is what the Bible says. Now, this text that underlines our King James Bible here, it uses that word, we love him. Now, some texts will drop the word him and say we love because of him or because he loved us. But we have that word in here because of a very important reason, because it directs us toward the Savior. We love him because he first loved us. This morning, with the Lord's help, I want to preach just for a few minutes on a sermon I've titled, Oh, How I Love Jesus. In our opening text here, it's been inspired, of course, by God. Everything in Scripture was inspired by God. Written by a human penman, of course. The human penman in this case would be the Apostle John. Now, sometimes you might have heard him referred to as the Apostle of Love. There's a very good reason for that. If you go and do a search in your Bible for the word love, you're going to find that the Apostle John uses it more than any other writer in all the New Testament. I went through and looked, and I found 180 times in our New Testament the word love is used. Out of those 180 times, I find the Apostle John used it 62 times. 33 times alone in 1 John. 33 times in this short little 5-chapter book of the Bible. And then over in the Gospel of John, he uses it 22 times in his Gospel, far more than any other Gospel writer. And then he uses it in 2 and 3 John, and then over in the book of Revelation. So more than any other writer in all the New Testament, the Apostle John uses the word love 62 times out of the 180. I believe he earned the title of the Apostle of Love. You may remember as he sat there as the Lord was given that final supper, and as he leaned over on his breast and referred himself as that disciple that Jesus loved. He referred himself as that many times. John, you might say, was in love. He was love struck. He was in love with Jesus the Savior. No, not the carnal kind of love that people down here think of, but that godly, heavenly love that only Jesus can provide. The only love that God can provide. There's no other love apart from God like this. He was in love with the Savior. He loved him dearly. May I say to you today that the only way that a person can truly love is if they know God, is if God is in their heart. That's the only way. Apart from God, you cannot love this way. It's impossible. You may say, well, Brother Byron, I met my wife or I met my husband before I was saved and I loved them. Well, you may have had some type of love for them, but you did not know true love until God entered into your heart. Until you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you never knew or experienced true love, because only God can provide that kind of love. How many people today would you go up to your spouse or maybe your girlfriend or boyfriend and you say, you know what, the only reason that I love you is because you love me first? You're not going to find many people doing that, are you? Because that'll probably draw a big old slice right in the middle of your relationship. But the Bible here says that we loved him because He first loved us. Friends, that's a Bible truth this morning. This type of love, if you look there in verses 7 and 8 of 1 John chapter 4, the Bible says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." I believe the Bible's pretty plain that to have love in your heart for your fellow man, for God Himself, you must have God's love within you, because that's where it comes from. Well, just before our opening text there in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 15, I want to read these three verses, 15 through 17. The Bible says, "Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love of God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world." Well, I began to think about that love the Bible talks about, the love that we have for Jesus. And as I told you, I titled the message, "Oh, How I Love Jesus." I want to give you 12 things this morning, very quickly, on why I love Jesus. And I pray that it's the same reasons that you love Him as well. Well, in that opening statement there, it talks about that we love Him because He first loved us. Well, I want you to know that I love Jesus because He loved me even when I was a sinner and I was lost and I was bound for a devil's hell. I love Him because of that, because He loved me even though I was a sinner. Romans 5 and 8 says, "But God commendeth His love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." One of the greatest mysteries in all the world is how God could have so much love for a person that He could look out upon and see that they were nothing but a wretched, miserable sinner. Yet the Bible says that even before that, He loved us. He loved us before we were ever saved. He loved us so much that He sent Jesus, His only Son, to die for us. How many kings do you suppose down here on earth would die for someone? How many kings down here do you think would pardon someone that openly defied them, that openly rebelled against them, that openly spit in their face, that openly cursed their name? How many kings on this earth do you think would do that? I want to tell you today, there would be no king on this earth that would do that. There's only one king that I know of that would do that, and that king is King Jesus. And He's the only one that I've ever heard in history that would die for a man, for a woman, that would openly defy Him, that openly would curse His name. Only Jesus would do that. Oh, the heavenly King Jesus, He died for us even while we were yet sinners and loved us, the Bible said. That's why I love Him. Secondly, I love Him. I love Jesus for what He's done for me, because He paid the price for my sin. He paid the price for my sin. Had it not been for Jesus, my destination this morning and your destination would be hell. Without Jesus, that is our destination. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." That word "wages" right there, that's an important word. That means your payment. What you are due for your deeds, your payment. It's kind of like when you go to work and you work a job. You know what? Your wages are your paycheck. Do you know what the wages of sin is? You know what you earn for sin? You earn death for sin. That is the wages of sin. And what does death mean? When the Bible talks about death, it's talking about a death going into an everlasting lake of fire, a place called hell, is when it refers to death. And that is what He's talking about. If Jesus had not died for me, I would be bound for a devil's hell, because the penalty for my sin is death in hell. I want you to know today that our paycheck is now going to be cashed in heaven. If you've been saved today, your paycheck is in heaven, not in a devil's hell. Why do I love Jesus? Because He paid the price of sin for me. I want you to know that Jesus hung on the cross and He endured the sufferings. He endured the beatings, the lashes, the spitting in His face, the cursing of His name, the little games where they smote Him in the face as they blindfolded Him and put Him around in circles and beat Him in the face and asked Him to guess who it was that hit Him. As He hung on the cross between the two thieves and one of them mocked Him and railed against Him, He still loved Him. As He went to that evil, cruel Roman cross and hung and died and shed His blood for us, friends, I want you to know He paid that penalty that day on that cross. I want you to know even as he looked out and he saw that old cruel Pilate, as Pilate washed his hands of Jesus' blood. As he looked down and saw Peter, who was supposed to be his friend, sitting by the fire and denying and cursing his name, he still loved him. As he looked out and he saw those people that were standing in the crowd saying, "Crucify him," he looked out and he looked at those people and he said, "I still love them." As he looked at the cruel Roman soldiers who tortured him and beat him and nailed him to the cross, as they were nailing those nails in his hands and in his feet, you know what he was saying? "I still love you." As he stood on that cross, as he hung on that cross and shed his blood, and he looked out in time, he looked out in the future, and he saw you, and he saw me, and he saw us sitting on a church pew perhaps, or maybe wherever it was that you received Christ. He looked out and he saw you, and he said, "I know the sinner that they are, and you know what? I still love them." And you know what he did? He still died for our sins. Why do I love Jesus? Because he paid the penalty. He paid the price for my sins. I didn't have to hang on the cross and die. I didn't have to go to a devil's hell because Jesus paid it for me. Thirdly, I love Jesus for sending his Holy Spirit to convict me and to point me to Christ. Jesus, as he was going away, he said, "I will send you another comforter. I will send the Holy Spirit." And as Jesus left, the Holy Spirit came, and the Holy Spirit now dwells within those that are saved. The Holy Spirit speaks to you. The Holy Spirit leads you. If you've been saved today, that is, if you've not been saved, the Holy Spirit only convicts you and convicts your heart until you do get saved. And then he moves inside of you and he lives in you and he directs your paths. I love Jesus because he sent that Holy Spirit to convict me. Jesus is not here in the flesh any longer. Jesus now is manifest through the Holy Spirit. He is now within us through the Holy Spirit. I'll never forget, and if I've gave my testimony once, I gave it 1,000 times, and I'll give it 1,000 more before I die. I want you to know, as I sat in Elm Street Baptist Church, Knoxville, Tennessee, back in 1972, when I was 6 years old, and I was there for vacation Bible school, and I sat on the pew about back there where Sister Shirley's sitting right now, was about the location of where I was sitting, as the pastor stood up and he preached the Word of God, and he told me about Jesus, and he told me about the sin in my life that was going to send me to a devil's hell. I want you to know that the Holy Spirit, he came and he convicted me of my sins. The first he began by knocking on my heart's door as I felt my little heart pitter-patter. I was 6 years old. I'd not done anything real bad, but I want you to know today, I want you to know, one little sin, one little lie, one little fib is enough to send you to hell. I want you to know I was a little 6-year-old bound for hell that day, and the Holy Spirit came and he started knocking on my heart's door, and I felt that conviction and I wanted to resist. I wanted to hold back. I didn't want to go forward. I didn't want to get made fun of. I didn't want to get laughed at by my friends. I didn't want to walk down there in front of everybody. But you know what? Then the Holy Spirit, he quit knocking and he started grabbing and he started pulling on that heart of mine, and I knew that I had to go forward and I had to confess of my sins and trust Jesus as my Savior, or I was going to die and go to hell. Friends, I want you to know that day Jesus saved me. And when he saved me eternally, everlasting, never to be taken away from me. He saved me forever. On that day, as a 6-year-old boy, have I lived my life for him all the time exactly as what he would have me to? No, I have not. I'll be the first to tell you that I have not lived the life that I should have. And I want you to know one thing, though. Jesus has never left me the whole time. He's never left me, regardless of what I've done to him. I entered into that service that night as a lost sinner bound for hell, and I left that service that morning, that night, as a saved little boy on his way to heaven, on his way to glory bound that day to go to the promised land. Fourthly, I love Jesus because he saved me. He wrote my name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and he gave me eternal life. I've already told you right then, when I got saved, I inherited eternal life. I'm not one of those that preach that you can be saved and then be taken away, because that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that once you've been saved, if you've been truly saved, you are saved eternally, everlasting, never to be taken away. I want you to know today, at the times in my life when I was a child growing up and I would do things against my father would whip me, he would chasten me, he would get the belt out on me, and you know what? He never told me, "You don't belong to me. Get out of my house and don't come back." He never did that. You know why? Because because he loved me. I was his son and he was my father. I want you to know today, if you've been saved, you are a son of God and he is your father, and he is not going to kick you out of his house. I want you to know he will chasten you for those sins, but he will not kick you out of his house. I love him because he saved me and he wrote my name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. John 6:37, Jesus says, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. I want you to know he came to me, he convicted me, he forgave me, and he saved me. He didn't come and abuse me. He didn't come and whip me. He didn't come and make fun of me. He didn't come to beat me down, but he came to save me and to love me. That's what he came for to do. He wrote my name down in that book, and he gave me eternal life. Fifthly, I love Jesus because he stayed with me my entire life and has never left me. And I've already told you the times I've strayed from the Lord. I you know, after I got saved as just a little boy, I probably didn't have enough guidance. You know, people tell me you need to do this and do that, and you know, you just go on your merry way like a lot of people do. But I want you to know there was times in my life when I strayed from the Lord. There's times when I got out of church and wasn't doing what I needed to do. But I want you to know the whole time that I was doing that, he was still speaking to me. He was still tugging at my heart. And there was Sundays that I would lay out of church. I would go out of church and I'd be afraid to drive by the church and go somewhere because I thought somebody would see me. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit was convicting me. You need to be in my house, is what he was saying. Friends, I want you to know, I saw this week all over social media that this is go back to church Sunday. I didn't know there was ever a leave the church Sunday. This is every Sunday is a go to church Sunday. Friends, I want you to know that Jesus, he stayed with me my entire life. He said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He gave that promise 4 or 5 times in the Bible that I can find. You know, I've had earthly friends here said, Brother Byron, you know, I love you. And, I, you know, if you ever pastor a church, I'll come to your church. I'll be faithful. I'll be loyal. And you know what? I look around and I don't see a nary one of those. I don't see some of these friends that said, Brother Byron, you're one of my best friends. I don't see those friends any longer. You know why? Because they've left and they've forsaken me. But you know what? Jesus never has. Jesus has never done anything. You can look at somebody the wrong way these days and they'll leave you and they'll forsake you right away. And they won't have nothing else to do with you for the rest of your life. Jesus is not like that. I want you to know, if there's not another living soul on this earth that wants anything to do with you, Jesus Christ wants you. He loves you and he will never leave you nor forsake you. He'll be with you all your life. He's been by my side for 42 years since I've been saved. Friends, I want you to know that thrills me today through thick and thin, through the good times and bad times. He's always been there for me. What would we do without Jesus? I said the other day, how does people face life if they don't know Jesus as their Savior? How do they get through? Is it the alcohol? Is it the drugs? Is it the sexual things that they do? What is their way of coping with these things? All of those. Friends, I want you to know today the way that we can cope with life is to know that Jesus will never leave us. All we got to do is turn to him and ask him for help. And he loves you enough that he'll spread open those big loving arms. He'll wrap them around your old sinful neck and he'll love you and hold on to you. He loves you that much. I love him because he's never left me. Even those times I've willfully sinned against him, those times I've defied him, friends, I want you to know he's never left me. Never, ever left me. Sixth, I love Jesus for daily forgiving me of my sins. Daily forgiving me of my sins. When we're saved, our flesh is not made perfect. You know, when you get saved, you get sanctified. You know what that means? You've been made holy. You've been made pure enough that you can stand before the Heavenly Father. When you got saved, you got sanctified. But I want you to know this flesh of ours did not. This flesh of ours is still nailed to that old sin. That old sin nature is still in us. If you ever hear somebody stand up and say, friends, I want you to know if you've been saved, then sin shouldn't bother you any longer. That's a lie right there. I want you to know the Apostle Paul himself, he said that Jesus Christ came into this world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. He didn't say of whom I was chief. He said of whom I am chief. I want you to know that I can reflect on that today. I still sin in this old fleshly nature today. There's still things that try to grab at you and gnaw at you and try to tempt you and to try you. And that'll never go away until the day they lay our cold dead bodies in the ground or until the Lord Jesus comes and takes His church out of here. That sin nature will be with you. But you know what? I love Jesus because He forgives me daily of my sins. You know, the Bible says that He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. All we got to do is simply say, Father, forgive me. I've sinned. And you know what? He says, forgiven, forgiven. Do you know when He died on that cross, all sin past, all sin future, and all sin present has been forgiven when Jesus died on the cross. Amen, this morning. The psalmist David, a man the Bible said was a man after God's own heart. And we all know what happened as he was tempted as he stood on his rooftop and he looked over in his neighbor's house and there was that beautiful woman, Bathsheba. And as he committed that sin with her and they had the child and he had her husband, Uriah, as he had him murdered on the battlefield. And all the sins that David did, but you know what? God convicted him of that as Nathan came in there and he said, "You're the man." And he was convicted in his heart. And you know what he says? Listen to what he said in Psalm 32 after this happened. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and whose spirit there's no guile. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned in the drought of summer. Selah, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Selah. You see what David did? He acknowledged that sin to the Lord. He confessed his sin, and he said that the whole time he was like that his bones waxed old through the roaring all day long because God was convicting him of those sins. And what did he do? He confessed and the Lord forgave him. He said, thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Seventh, I love Jesus for helping me live. Helping me live. Sometimes, I want you to know this morning, I'll tell you the dead level truth. I get out of bed and I don't want to face the day. I mean, I get up and I start thinking of all the problems. I start thinking about the workplace. Start thinking about all the turmoil and all the things going on. And friends, all I want to do is crawl back into bed, put the covers over my head, and go to sleep and not wake up for years. There's days that I'm like that. I want you to know it's only by the Lord Jesus. The only thing that I can do is call out His name and say, God, help me. Lord, help me. Jesus, help me this morning. Help me to be able to live this morning and get up and go to work. He's the only reason I don't go to work and hand in my resignation letter and walk out that door, because He helps me to live. That demanding workload, the stress of the ministry, the things in the family, money issues and everything else that goes on in our lives, they eat at us and they make us want to give up sometimes. But friends, there's no giving up. As long as you've got the Lord, He's there for you. I love Him because He helps me live. Eighth, I love Jesus because He gives me comfort in those times of sorrow, in those times of grief, when I've lost loved ones to death, and that thing called cancer that I hate, when I see the hatred in the world, when I look at the news and see beheading of American citizens and other folks and all around the world from the evil that's going on in other parts of the world, you know, my heart is at its lowest point. But Jesus said that I will send you another comforter. Listen to what He said to the disciples there in John 14 and 16. He said, I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another comforter. He's talking about, I'm leaving here, but I'm sending something else back, the comforter. Who's the comforter? The Holy Spirit. That He may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth Him, but ye know Him, for He dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. I love Jesus because He sent that comforter for me. If you've been saved today, He says right here that the Holy Spirit, that comforter, lives inside of you. And He's there to help you and to comfort you in those times when we're low, when we're down. I love Jesus because He answers my prayers. Ninth, I've heard people say, I pray, but the Lord never answers my prayers. I just don't know why I even try. I just give up on it because, honestly, He don't answer my prayer. Friend, I want you to know He answers your prayers. If you get down and you pray to Him, He answers your prayers. It may not be exactly the way that you want it to go. And a lot of times His answer is N-O, no. And it's always the best for us. And we, in our flesh, we think, well, Lord, I can't believe that you're not answering this prayer the way I want it answered. God, you know this person here that I love, and I see them dying, and God, I can't believe you're not going to allow them to live. And you think he's not answered your prayers. But he has. He does. He answers your prayers. Friends, if I didn't believe that Jesus answered our prayers, you know what I would do? I would lay down my Bible. I would walk out of this church through those doors, and I would never darken the doors of a church again in my life if I didn't believe that prayer was real and that he answered prayer. I've seen him do it in my life. I've seen him do it in the lives of my family. I've seen him do it in your lives. He answers those prayers, and I love him because of that. Tenth, I love Jesus for what he's going to do for me. Jesus is going to come for me. If you've been saved this morning, he's going to come for you. Now, whether he comes on that cloud of glory to rapture his church out of here, or whether you die and you close your eyes and you wake up in the presence of the Lord, he's coming for you. Listen to John 14, 2. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. If Jesus tarries his coming and we die, the Bible says, we're confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. I have a hope, I have a guarantee that when I leave this earth, whether it through death or whether we get raptured out of here, I'm going to be in the presence of the Lord. And I love him because of what he's going to do for me. When Jesus comes, he's going to transform this old body into a perfect body. Listen what 1 Corinthians 15:51 says. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. He's going to change these old vile bodies. That sin nature I was talking about, no longer will it be part of us. There'll be no sin in heaven. There'll be no sinful bodies. There'll be perfect people there. People like Jesus, and I love him for that. 11th, I love Jesus because he's going to reunite me with those loved ones that have went on before me, those that's been saved. He's going to reunite me with me. I can go all the way back to 1972. At 6 years old, I told you I was saved at 6 in 72. Something else happened in 72 of December of that year. In December 1972, my grandfather, Preacher Ed Spencer, the founder of this church, the founder of North Acres Church, pastored here for about 8 or 9 years, pastored over there 18 years. I want you to know that the Lord saw fit to take him in 1972. I was a 6-year-old boy. I loved that man. I might have just been 6 years old, and you might have think, well, you don't even remember him. I remember him as well as I remember yesterday. I loved the man. I love to go with him places. I love for him to take me out to places. We go down to Mitchell's Barbershop, walk in, and I was the proudest little grandson that you can imagine because I was with my grandfather, Ed Spencer, and everybody loved him, Preacher Spencer. He took him back in 1972. But you know what? I'm going to see him again. I'm going to see him again. You know, I think just a few years after that, somebody else in my life left. My grandmother, Bessie Chesney. Some of you all might have known her, some of you didn't. Bessie Chesney was Lorne's wife. You know Lorne, my grandfather. She was taken from us back when I was just a boy, and I remember her well. She was one of the sweetest, gentlest, kindest people I've ever known in my life. And it hurt when she left. But you know what? He's going to reunite me with her in heaven. Then I can keep going. I can go to 1992. I was 26 years old, been married for 7 years. We were about to have our first child. Jessica was going to be born in February the next year. Back then, my granny Spencer, she was taken from us from cancer. She was taken. And friends, I'd lost people before in my life, but never in my life had anything affected me as when Granny Spencer died. It hurt. It was bad. And I didn't think I would get over it, but I want you to know I'm going to see her again. I'm going to be in heaven, and he's going to reunite me with those loved ones. And I can't help but say, just a few years back, 2002, my sister, Pam, my big sister that I love with all my heart, 39 years old, was taken from cancer. And she left here. And my life has never been the same. There's not a day that I wake up that I don't think of her and remember her. Friends, I'm going to get to see her again. Because he loves us and he was going to reunite us with those loved ones that went on. I could go on and keep naming people I've lost. My grandmother, grandfather, Lorne, my Aunt Barbara, all these people that mean so much to me. But I love him because one day he's going to reunite me with those that we love. One day. 12th and final. I love Jesus because he's going to keep me by his side forever. Forever. Oh, my friend, there's coming a day when no heartaches shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, what a glorious day that's going to be. I love him because he's going to keep me in heaven with him forever. He's going to be by my side. Never going to have to wonder. Never going to have to worry. Never going to have to preach another message. Never going to have to go share the gospel with anybody. Because in heaven, we've got the gospel right there in front of us. The Lord Jesus, he's going to be with us right by our side. That dying thief hung on that cross. I want you to know that Jesus said this to him, the one that trusted him as Savior. Luke 23 and 43, Jesus told him, "Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Friends, if you've been saved, you're going to go to paradise. That's heaven. And you're going to be with Jesus. He told him that he would be with him in paradise. That promises to all those that's been saved. Everyone that's trusted Jesus as your Savior, one day you will be with him in paradise forever by his side. He made that promise that he would never leave us nor forsake us. That wasn't just for here on earth. That also included heaven. He'll never leave us or forsake us in heaven. I love Jesus because he's going to keep me by his side. Now, I want to ask you a question this morning as the ladies come and give the invitation number. And I want to do that song, What a Day That Will Be, page 30 in the inspiration hymnal. But what about you this morning? Do you love Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Has the Holy Spirit ever came and convicted you that you were a lost sinner bound for hell? And that you needed to repent of your sin and trust Jesus as your Savior? Has there ever been a time that He has ever done that? If there's not, friend, you're not saved. You're not saved if you've never trusted Jesus as Savior. Now, as we stand this morning and sing this song together, I'm going to ask you, can you sing that song, "Oh, How I Love Jesus"? When you close your eyes in death, are you assured of a place called paradise, called heaven, that we're going to go to one day? If you've been saved, you're going there. If you've not, you are not. I want us to pray together this morning before we sing, and then we're going to sing this number. And if you need to come to this altar for salvation, for a backslidden condition or whatever, something you're struggling with, I want you to come to the altar this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, just laying down everything at your feet. God, we can't do anything else. Lord, we've preached your word this morning. God, we've preached the truth. And Lord, we're just asking for you now to deal with hearts. God, that Holy Spirit that you sent here, Lord, in your place, God, would you walk up and down these aisles, Lord, and convict hearts? Are there those this morning, Lord, that are either lost or backslidden? Or maybe, God, they're dealing with some problem, Lord, that they just keep dragging around like an old ball and chain. God, may this be the day that you convict them and show them the need to come to you, Lord, and make things right. Is there one here today? God, help us today as we sing.